ahead and get started. This is the Lintian Bath for anybody who's in the wrong place. My name is Russ Alberry. I'm the most active Lintian maintainer at the moment. And I don't have anything particularly prepared. This Bath was kind of scheduled at the last minute. But you can talk over sort of what's been going on with Lintian for the last year or so. And then sort of what I see is the big things that are out there right now that probably need to get done to it. And then I expect most of this is just going to be general discussion. So feel free to interrupt me or whatever as we go. I talk too fast, so I'll try to slow down, but feel free to let me know if you miss something or whatever. So I've been working on Lintian for about a year. It was one of the first things I did after I got out of NM. And at this point, we're in the happy state where we're under 100 bugs again, and there are no bugs with priority higher than wish list that are open. Lintian is, sort of as a general goal, Lintian is a standalone package checker, which is very important, and something that not everybody quite understands. The idea of Lintian is that it does static checks on a single Debian package. It doesn't know anything about the rest of the archive. It doesn't know anything about any external data sources. It doesn't know anything about the bug tracker, about open bugs, anything along those lines. And that's very intentional in its design. There's a lot of other interesting QA things that you can do in the archive if you look at the whole archive or if you also look at the bug tracker. And it's great for other people to write those, maintain those. The goal of Lintian is to be something that you can run on a single package, hopefully relatively securely, even if the package is nasty. If you run the same version of Lintian on the same package, you should always get the same results, which is important for us to be able to maintain lintian.debian.org and have its output be stable. Lintian has a variety of bugs that are priority wish list and are tagged won't fix that we keep open because they're basically ideas for how to do cross-package checks or full archive checks that no one has implemented yet. And I just keep them there and open because they're a pretty reasonable repository of ideas for those kinds of things that people will do. They won't ever be done in Lintian itself because they're kind of outside of its design parameters. So it's an interesting place to look if you're looking for ideas for things to do across the archive. My top priority in Lintian is to try to get rid of as many false positives as I can. That's the reason why I'm particularly happy that we don't have any bugs that are higher than priority wish lists that are still open. Wish list bugs are usually requests for please check this, please check that, please look for this thing that we aren't looking for currently. Anything that where there's a false positive or Lintian diagnoses something that it shouldn't is a priority higher than that, and I try to get all those closed before each release of Lintian. There are a few places where Lintian just can't. The check that you want Lintian to do is very useful, and it just is going to have false positives on some packages, and so for those we just tell people to use overrides, and there are a few of those. But my goal is to get all of those where, if you have this and it really is legitimate, you should use an override, documented in a long description of the tag. So when you run Lintian-I, you should see in the tag description, if this was intentional, please use an override. A really good example of that is setuid or setgid programs. Lintian, by default, will produce a tag for every setuid or setgid program in your package. That's not necessarily a bug. It may be something that's entirely intentional, that's what the package should do. But I think that the check is useful enough, and it's important enough that you be aware that you have setuid or setgid programs in your package, that I want to keep that check. But that means that any package that has a setuid or setgid program should add an override that says, yes, I know there's a setuid or setgid program. So that's kind of where we're at right now. I don't have a lot of time to work on Lintian, but I try to go back and implement one or two of the wish list bugs each time we do a release. Sometimes I get to more of them. There's certainly a big opportunity for people to help out by looking at the wish list, find some check that you think you could do or that looks cool or whatever, and implement it and provide a patch. It's great to have those patches. It makes my life a lot easier. We can integrate those pretty quickly. Lentian.debian.org was down, was not being updated for a while, for about 6 months or so. Fixed that recently. It's now running the latest version of Lentian again, and should be relatively up to date. I went through Lentian.debian.org after I resurrected it and looked for false positives in some of the obvious places and cleaned up a whole bunch of them. But it's another good place to look. It's a particularly good place to look if you're looking for false positives where Lentian is doing, getting something wrong that nobody's bothered to report. Because Lentian.debian.org, you can page through and see, oh, does that look legitimate? Does that look like a real problem? There's a note on Lentian.debian.org, and I mentioned this in another talk, that says that that people shouldn't file mass bugs based on Lentian results, that the Lentian maintainers will do that from time to time. Well, the Lentian maintainers aren't doing that from time to time. I really don't have the time to do that, and neither does anyone else on the maintenance team. But so it would be, if anybody wants to look for Lentian tags that look like they represent real archive problems and start looking at doing mass bug filings based on those, I think that would be a great thing for somebody to volunteer to do. Please talk to us about it first on the Lentian Maint mailing list, because in some cases the tags don't represent problems that are of sufficient severity to warrant a mass bug filing, or there's a known place where the tag isn't really entirely accurate. And sometimes there's one tag is better than another for looking for a particular problem. That's generally where I think Lentian is at right now. Where I think it needs to go is that right now Lentian has exactly 3 levels of tag severity. There are errors, there are warnings, and there are info messages. My goal, I think that it should be possible for just about any Debian package, apart from the override thing that I mentioned earlier, to be clean, Lentian clean on all 3 levels, all the way through info. I check all of my packages with dash capital I, and I clean up all of my info tags. But there are a lot of info tags that are for problems, that not everyone agrees are really problems, or that affect so many packages and aren't particularly important, that they sit there at the info level. A good example of that one is, it turns in the NROS specification, if you want to enter a literal dash as for like an option in a command page, you're supposed to put a backslash in front of it. And that's been the case since the beginning of the whole of NROS. Lots of upstreams just don't do that, because it's always worked. Unless you printed out your man page using GROF and PostScript and actually printed it on a printer, you can't tell the difference in the GROF and the man program in most distributions between having a backslash in front of it or not having a backslash in front of it. And even if you do print the whole thing out, it isn't completely obvious what the difference is. There are some subtle differences, though, because if you don't put the backslash in front of the hyphen, GROF will consider that a point at which it can break the line. So if you've got a long option, like the new long options, and you don't backslash the hyphens, GROF will wrap in the middle of the hyphen and in the middle of the line and do other weird kind of things. Also, for a while, we turned on support in GROF for Unicode hyphens. So you've got real hyphens or real dashes, at which point, if you don't have the backslash in front, when you search through the man page for dash something, you don't actually find the option because it's not a dash, it's an actual hyphen. Anyway, so Lentian notices those, Lentian diagnoses those. However, there are tons of packages in the archive with this problem, and tons of man pages with this problem. And eventually the GROF maintainer just gave up and went back to making dashes even if they're not backslash. So that's an example of Lentian info tag. There are a few other things like that in Lentian where it's just kind of sitting there, and it is a bug, but it's just not a bug that's high enough priority to really get that exercised about. But the 3 severity thing is really limiting. And the difference between errors and warnings is often kind of fuzzy. Errors mean it's a violation of a policy must directive, or it means your package just won't work, or it means it's something that's really severe, or it means it's something that's kind of severe but we're really certain that it's actually broken, or it may mean something that's not that severe but it's so easy to fix that you should just fix it. But all those things are errors. Warnings are things that are like incredibly severe except that we get it wrong a lot, or there are things that aren't particularly severe, or there are policy should violations, or we weren't sure if it really could be an error, so we made a warning. And then there's the problem that a lot of people just run Lentian rather than giving it any options, so they never see the info tags. So there's two, basically error and warning are the tags everybody sees, and people, for when they say the package of Lentian clean, usually treat them pretty interchangeably. And info tags, you know, a much smaller percentage of people ever even see them. So that's not particularly great, and it doesn't let you do some really interesting things that other people, particularly Manoj, has been wanting to do. For example, it would be great if Lentian knew which tags in Lentian came from policy directives. Because then you could do run Lentian and say, show me only the policy violations. I don't care about, you know, what the man page for DevHelper said, or what, you know, what the developer's reference might have told me to do. I want to only see the policy violations. And or you might want to see only the developer's reference violations or things along those lines. So the idea of tagging with the source of the check is, I think, pretty important. The second thing that I'd like to do is, we have this severity mixed in with how sure we are there's actually a problem. Those should be separated. There should be a severity, which is policy must, should, or recommends, or is your package is broken, your package might be broken, you know, that kind of a level of thing. And then there's Lentian's really sure, Lentian's kind of sure, Lentian is not sure at all, on a kind of a different metric. And so it needs to be those three different types of classifications of the tags in Lentian. Once we have that, we can do some really interesting things. For example, you could have DAC run Lentian with flags that say, only show me tags where Lentian is sure is a policy issue and it violates a must. And if Lentian returns any tags, it could reject the upload. You can't use Lentian to reject uploads in DAC right now because there's just too much other stuff in there, and including stuff that not all the developers agree with. So that's a big project. That's going to be quite a lot of work. The tag code in Lentian is pretty complicated, and we need to figure out a fairly rational mapping, because you probably want to generally map the stuff back to error warning and info or something very like it for most of the time, unless people are giving these extra flags, or at least simplify because if you give people a three-dimensional grid point at the beginning of each tag, that's probably more information than they actually want. We also have to, of course, go through every check. Many of them do have references already noted in the check, but a lot of them don't. A lot of them that actually have references don't have a reference noted. Some of them, there isn't really a reference. So we have to go through and do all that classification. So that's a project that I'm probably not going to have time to work on extensively, particularly soon, but if somebody wanted to volunteer to work on that, it would be great, and it's something that I do intend to make happen at some point.
Two things, of course, the Lentian codes need to be fixed in the classification, so you also don't have time to work on actually making it possible to do the classification.
Right. Yeah. And then the second thing that does need some to be looked at is the documentation in general, and also the long tag descriptions. The long tag descriptions need to be edited in general for consistency. There's a lot of places where they use backtick, forward tick as quote marks, which we should stop doing. There's a lot of differing styles in the way things are presented. In particular, Lentian.debian.org does support some degree of HTML markup, but the way that markup is used in the long descriptions is completely inconsistent. And we need to track down references for everything that has references. There's also a Lentian manual, which I don't know if anybody's edited any time particularly recently.
I think no reason to alter the last one to fix it. It's just 201-ish?
Yeah.
It's a bit old. Well, it has been updated for when I fixed the override, so that's about it.
So I'm guessing there's stuff in there that's out of date that needs to be filled with. I personally would rather rewrite the man pages for Lentian and Pod, and because right now they're sort of oddly double-spaced in places, and there's some other kind of weird bits to get into how they're written in NROC might make them a little bit more maintainable. So there's generally some documentation issues that I think are worth looking at. Those, and then there's also sort of in the blue sky territory, there's the idea that Manoj had for putting together some kind of pseudocode or other kind of technical description of a policy statement in such a fashion that you could write, you could have Lintian take a pseudocode directly from policy and interpret it as a check. That's definitely way out there. It definitely is some kind of thing that would need some, it's the kind of thing that I could very easily see being a master's or a doctoral thesis. If somebody wanted to take all the work that various people have put in proof theory and programming and the languages that people have constructed around doing, around proving properties of programs, and figure out how we might be able to describe parts of Debian policy in that fashion, I think that would be really interesting. I'm not sure that it's going to happen short of somebody actually deciding that sounds really cool and I have a background in doing proof theory. So that's pretty much what I had is kind of a general overview and a general state of things. I'm really interested in other people's you know, ideas, thoughts, experiences with Lintian, things that you think Lintian should do, ways in which we can use Lintian in the project, bugs that you really want to get fixed.
Very interesting to do a straw poll. Who is interested in actually working on Lintian itself, like the core of Lintian, who thinks it might be interesting to get into? Anyone? Besides Lintian at the institutions? And who's interested in maybe writing some extra checks that like fetch whatever? Okay, so that's slightly more. So, and on good thing, like idea to who likes to throw in some nice ideas of what we could do with Lintian, but you're not willing to actually write a code for that, which is also very nice. So, okay.
Hopefully, maybe writing new checks would involve writing additional code into Lintian.
Yeah, but not like the core is more like the infrastructure, how Lintian itself works, and the, for example, the tag classification codes and stuff like that. Writing tests is less difficult to do. You don't actually need to understand all of Lintian, just the checking code, which is much less to understand.
I've probably written maybe 100 checks since I started working on Lintian. I would say that 95% of them were less than 20 lines of Perl. In general, there's enough stuff there already that most of the infrastructure
is. Once you understand what kind of information is already available, it's pretty easy to. A lot of checks also are probably similar to some existing tags, so it makes it additionally easy.
Guidelines of Perl can be quite difficult.
Yeah, but a lot of it, I've been trying to, as much as possible, move checks out of code and into data, wherever there's a whole class of tests that we do very similarly. So, for example, there's a whole set of tests now for, you ran this program out of your Debian rules file, but you didn't build depend on the right package. And there's a whole, and now that's basically all data. You can just, you have a regex and a package that you have to depend on, and there's just a table you can update, and you don't have to change a line of code. I want to do more of that. I also want, Lintian has grown organically over the years, and it's kind of messy, and there's pieces that are duplicated in different places. There's various things that really need to get pulled out into a library and used in a cleaner fashion. We finally have a fairly solid library for doing dependency analysis that can handle all of the version relationships that we have in Debian, and that can do things like, you know, does this set of dependencies imply this set of dependencies? And I'm digging out now every single, all the different code that parses dependencies and replacing it with that library, except for the one piece of code that parses the depends line and looks for syntax errors, because it has to be a little bit more robust than the regular library. Another example of the kind of thing that needs to get pulled out into a library is that right now we do checks for bashisms in shell scripts in maintainer scripts, there's a few that we're modifying policy to say are fine, using local, using test-a, test-o. I think the general project consensus was that we shouldn't be worrying about that because all of our shells support that. But there's a bunch of other stuff that only bash does that is less common, which we check for in maintainer scripts right now. There's several bugs out there that say, you know, please check init scripts, please check your Debian rules file, please check all the other scripts that are on the package. And so that code needs to get pulled out to a library that can check a line of shell or that can untangle a line of shell or whatever, and then call it several different places, check different scripts. Even better would be something that could actually understand the syntax of a shell script, because right now we have a bunch of places where we're trying to analyze post-install other types of maintainer scripts and say, you know, does it call this, does it call that, do you delete a device file, which policy says you're not allowed to do, do you do this, do you do that, and right now it's all kind of regex matching on shell code, which is scary. And there's like all this code in there to deal with the fact that people might put things that we think are a problem inside a here doc. So it's actually not, it's a string and not actually code, and you have to detect that. And, you know, if somebody ever wanted to write a shell parser in Perl that understood Born Shell, Lintian would use it. It would be actually let us write several checks that right now are just really difficult to do. Alternatively, we could stop using Born Shell for all the maintainer scripts and use something that actually had, you know, closer defined semantics and wasn't quite as general for and have like an escape if you really needed Born Shell. But I have a package that uses a Perl maintainer script, so I'm probably not one to throw stones. Yeah.
What about the influences between Lynda and Lintian? The maintainers, the concept, and so on.
I'd love there to be more. As near as I can tell, Lynda's pretty dead at the moment. There haven't, at least, I mean, I'm pretty sure that I have it installed in my system and therefore would be seeing new packages as they come out. And I haven't seen a new upload of Lynda in 2 years, something like that. There was one, okay. I must have just missed it then. Oh, really? Oh, if it was last week, that would explain it, because the system on which I would notice those uploads is not the system I have while I'm. Well, I've been busy recently.
The previous one was almost 1 year ago.
Okay.
Stephen K. more active in the recently, but he's still going on.
I don't have a good feel for what Lynda does that Lintian doesn't, or vice versa. I do know that Lynda tried to do some shared library analysis that I think was probably a bad idea that we decided not to do in Lintian, and that was the source of most of the recent bug activity that I'd seen. I know Python, but I don't know Python well, and I don't know Python well enough really to dig into the source code and kind of try to figure out exactly what it's doing. And you know, I don't know if the Lynda maintainer has ever really participated in the Lintian list or anything.
Not really. I've talked to him quite a bit when I started with the Lintian stuff, and I was like, I really didn't think it was very productive use of developer energy to write two tools with the same goal. But we couldn't like get to some agreement on merging things on one way or the other. So you can would like to like keep writing Lynda codes on his own, and was fine with it, and he's looking into Lintian, whatever there happens to take it over. And well, otherwise he said, yeah, just follow the code, or actually delete Lintian and just Lynda. So yeah, well, it didn't really go anywhere.
Okay. You know, I'd be happy to integrate more and discuss more. I don't really have the time personally to analyze Lynda and like look for ideas. You know, my feeling is that Lintian's undergone a lot of maintenance and a lot of improvements recently. You know, we've been averaging about 1.5 to 2 uploads a month for the last year with pretty long change logs. And you know, there's just a lot of stuff that changes about package checking, and I think it's, unless it's actively maintained, it's difficult for it to stay really focused on the problem the archive is having right now. I mean, stuff like the X transition, you almost have to get a checker release out almost right away when things start, because otherwise you lose a lot of the benefit of having the checker pick up the problem. I can certainly understand, though, why somebody would want to start over with something that they felt they could structure more cleanly than the Lintian code, because the Lintian code, and there's several different structuring ideas in there. It's like a lot of code bases that have been around for a long time. There's a lot of transitions to a better structure that are 90% done. And that's another thing that definitely does need more work on it. And it's the old, you know, start over versus incrementally change thing. I used to be a start over person, I'm now an incrementally change person. But it's kind of a coding style difference.
I mean, as in the Lintian infrastructure, it's not like unimaginable to have like Python code tests in it. Now it's actually the tests are included in Perl instead of executed. They used to be executed, then it was really easier. But well, the Lynda code is like those tests really want to be inside Lynda. Of course, like it could be merged, but it's not like there's interest from both sides to make it happen.
But it's definitely necessary to know Perl to run tests. You could not use Python, as I said, as you said before.
Now it's a little bit trickier. I mean, there's like not a single example of this, but it's not very neat to do, but well, if people would like to really run some huge bit of extra Lintian codes and they insist on Python, I mean, I wouldn't be the person to veto it. I'm not really sure what Rush thinks of it, but.
I mean, I think if it's a comprehensive, large check that looks really useful and the implementer happened to use Python, I think we should seriously consider just including it. And the other thing is that, you know, I know both Python and Perl, and the thought process behind figuring out what to check and the process of testing it on enough packages to be sure that the check is reasonable is the hard part of writing the check. The actual implementation is usually not the hard part. So I'm quite happy to have people file bugs against Lintian and give me a check written in Python, and I can rewrite it to Perl. I mean, that's not hard. The hard part is figuring out what to check and how.
That's also true. So, would there be any real interest for people to write stuff in Python instead?
No, actually, this was for me the interesting part for Lisa, because I don't know anything about Perl,
okay.
But I like the program Python. And therefore, I was very interested in Lisa, you know, disappointed that there's no ongoing development. But on the other hand, for me,
a lot of this is like coming up with some smart way to actually programmatically find some problem that you might, as a human, you can easily say, oh my god, what's this maintainer doing over there? But to actually code that into a program, that's very often very tricky to do. So, what was that?
Yeah, and there's a lot of wish list bugs if you look at the Lintian list that are basically sitting, Lintian bug list that are basically sitting there waiting for somebody with a really neat idea of how to try to analyze them. Like for example, there's a wish list bug that's asking for us to check to see if init scripts follow the policies document in terms of their output format, and that's I'm not even sure where to start on how to actually do that. Now, having a shell parser would be nice.
As long as it's not written in the shell?
Well,
So, the bulk is taking on?
We have another half hour, although if we end up a little bit early so that people can get upstairs for the talk that starts immediately when we end, that probably is the horrible thing. People are thinking about ideas. We have a bunch of people in the room, I will appeal for the idea see if anybody knows anything about how I can solve the second oldest bug against Lintian. It's one of the nice things about working on old wish list bugs in Lintian is that you occasionally get to close 5-digit bug numbers, which are getting increasingly rare in Debian. So there's a request that we check to make sure that all shared libraries are built with --D_reentrant. Policy also says that you're supposed to build all shared libraries with --reentrant. As near as I can tell, almost all shared libraries in Debian are not built with --reentrant. The bug was filed almost 8 years ago, and I have no idea if we care anymore. If we don't care anymore, we should take it out of policy, because policy still claims that you have to do this. And you know, that basically when this bug was filed, we were using Linux threads and glibc, and you know, it was a completely different world. And I just, so does anybody have any idea the history of that random collection of Debian developers?
You should ask people like me to watch the function.
Yeah, I think I asked Steve once before, and he was like, oh yeah, I vaguely remember that, but I have no idea. So it's sitting there. There was some idea of how to implement it, and I haven't implemented it entirely because I don't think we actually want to, because the archive doesn't seem to have exploded and isn't doing this currently, but...
I have no idea.
Anyone else with any ideas, comments, suggestions, concepts? I could ask you to talk about how you see Wintian working with MOL. Other topics?
Yeah,
well, so what are the pieces left for us to, say, produce lintian.debian.org via MOL?
For that to happen, it's basically one of the easy things that you could use MOL to make lintian.debian.org from it, and would like a package tracking system, like overview of each package with Lintian tests, and get a free overview of which tags, tag summary on the main page and stuff like that. I think MOL is particularly useful for like the things where you want to check packages for things that depend on the environment, so which are not static. And I don't think there's that much relation to MOL can help very much Lintian here, because Lintian is a static checker, and whatever would be nice to do can happen within Lintian itself. I don't really see on the focus itself of Lintian anything that MOL particularly can help with, except making it a bit more accessible, the results. And in supporting mass filings based on Lintian tags, I think MOL can be of help by maintaining infrastructure to actually mark a certain tag as, okay, this book is the book that's filed based on this tag, or this tag has been reviewed by a human to be a false positive, so RBR should not file it, and the rest will automatically be tags that still needs a human to look into.
That's very useful, the being able to keep track of what's been decided to be a false positive.
Yeah. That is something that MOL can be of assistance of. I don't think in the actual checking that MOL can be of any significant help at all. It's not the purpose. And as in like checking things where you actually want to find out which symbols are provided anywhere in the archive, for example, that is things that you can do in MOL. There's currently no real software doing that. One of the works that was found on Lintian like ages ago, I don't remember the work number, was like checking whether a symbol is being used, which library that corresponds to. You can maybe find conflicting symbols across the archive. For example, if you would like from all shared libraries and all the archive extract the symbol name, you can find out which ones conflict and then throw some alerts about that. I'm not myself very intimately familiar with all kinds of linking and C symbol stuff, so I would definitely need help from people or people with good ideas of what you could actually do do with MOL in this regard.
Yeah,
because I don't know which kinds of things would cause problems.
Various checks for shared library dependencies, SO names, and that sort of thing are high on the list of things that people tend to file wish list bugs against Lintian for. Things like binaries in bin should only use libraries in /lib and not libraries in /userlib. That's another kind of thing that Lintian can't check because Lintian doesn't have any idea where the library is coming from.
Well, we're using all inputs to implement because you could, like, for all symbols, you could check which library is this from, store where the library is in /lib or not, or in /userlib, and then give an appropriate alert if indeed a binary in slash bin is actually using something from the user bin.
And another example of that is that there was a recent bug file that said asking Lintian to check that init scripts that are in the rcs.d directory need to only use binaries from bin and sbin because user may not be mounted yet. Currently, Lintian can check to see if you give the full path of the binary in the init script that it's not a full path that's outside of bin and sbin. But if you use the unqualified name of the binary, Lintian doesn't know what package is coming from and therefore does, and also doesn't know where it's located. So that's another kind of thing that would be good.
Because you first need to map in from binary to where is it.
Yep. So that's where I'm hoping to hand off a lot of those all kind of across the whole library, across the whole archive sort of checks into the whole infrastructure.
I'm wondering whether it would make sense to actually package and make some tool that can do some, or that you would like write individual scripts that we use directly plug into MOL. It is definitely useful to have something you can actually install yourself easily because it's packaged. And I'm not really sure whether that would be possible because it would depend on the MOL infrastructure basically to do cross archive checks. So, maybe people have ideas how it would be possible to have like a standalone program which really uses MOL. I mean, if you need to query it a lot, I probably could actually make some remote querying possible so that actually when you have on your own system a certain package, you can ask it to use the MOL database from unstable remotely when you are on your own computer to actually get the information needed to throw up the checks, the archive-wide checks over there. So maybe that would be possible. So that would mean a new program, new checker program. But it's not really related to PIN. Now, of course, it's like a package checker, but it's like separate from Lintian.
Another thing I was going to mention, actually, if someone has free time to work on, Lintian.debian.org is pretty spectacularly ugly. Because it's basically just the simplest HTML that you can generate from a bunch of tags. If someone who wants to go through and clean up things like the fact that we do an H2 tag followed by an H1 tag, and maybe provide some CSS and make it look, you know, less ugly, that would be great. Another kind of thing that I don't really have time to do, but I don't think would be particularly difficult. Debian doesn't really have a general theme for web pages, but if I were, grabbing for ideas for what it could look like, I'd probably look at the BTS. The new BTS web interface seems pretty clean and pretty simple, but less ugly. And something similar to that would probably be great for Lintian.
Maybe also make a new Lintian logo which actually uses the current Debian logo instead of the one before that. And the Penguin is like not Debian's logo for quite a while already. Oh, what was it again?
You if you have a chicken or a penguin.
Yeah, well.
So, and there's all sorts of interesting data mining things that you can do on Lintian.debian.org that I have thought about but not actually done. I did recently fix the code that generates this page so that it will tell you how many overridden tags there are, at which point I discovered that there's 10,729 in the archive. Which seems awfully high. Now, there are some places where we do encourage people to use overrides. I mean, there's an override there for almost every set UID program anywhere in Debian, so there's a few. And I know there's a bunch of overrides for some Lintian checks around shared libraries. Lintian will give you a warning if you have a package that contains more than one shared library, or if you have a package whose name doesn't match the shared library name. And in some cases, those are not problems that the maintainer actually should fix, because there are things that if you're packaging a new shared library, you should not do it that way. But if you have an existing shared library in Lintian where you have a bunch of things that already depend on that particular package name, changing that package name just to match the package naming convention is not really a good idea, and the release team doesn't really want you to do that. So I know there's some sources like that that produce a fair number of overrides, but I don't think those produce 10,729. So, and that would be an interesting thing to look at and figure out what people are overriding, why people are overriding it. I know that a lot of those are probably false positives in Lentian. This, you know, something was easier to add the override than to file the bug. Or the bug could have been filed during a period. Well, I mean, if there was a bug, I probably found it. But it's hard to tell. Stuff can drop. And there are certainly plenty of tags to investigate as to whether or not there are real problems. I mean, there's 8,054 error tags across the entire archive. There's 45,854 warnings. There's a lot of stuff in warnings, and a lot of that is standards version warnings, which you should be aware of when you're uploading your package, but once the package has been uploaded, they're not horribly interesting. So those, you can kind of filter those out, but there's still quite a bit there, and every once in a while I go poking through there and look at packages and, you know, notice that packages have problems that I think are fairly obvious problems, and then think about filing a bug, and then sometimes file a bug, but usually don't. I think there's a lot that can be done in QA just by, you know, using the data mining results that we've already got here in terms of what's showing up.
Why don't you just display a warning when an override doesn't override, actually, if a test doesn't give a warning and it's overridden, why don't you just display a warning about the override not being useful?
It turns out that the Lentian does, actually. The problem with it is, well, there's two problems with it. One of them is that it's an info level tag. So you need to run Lentian-I in order to see it. That I'm of two minds about, because, I mean, I could increase it to a warning, but the problem is that there are cases where a package legitimately has an issue that comes and goes, in which case they may want to just overwrite it, but that problem may not be present in every version of the package, and it gets kind of annoying to take it in and out. I came up with an example of that one time back when I was thinking about this, and now the example completely escapes my mind. So maybe it isn't as big of a deal as I thought. So there's an argument that can be made that I could increase that to a warning. I will note, though, that overrides that don't actually override a tag, that are just kind of sitting there doing nothing, are not actually included in that 10,729 count. That's actually overridden tags that Lentian tried to issue. There's more than that are just sitting out there unused. The add user has a couple of overrides that are just not doing anything because it was a bug in Lentian we fixed a long time ago. The other problem with that tag, and the reason why you probably never saw it, even if you were using Lentian at the info level, is that for some reason the source code didn't issue that tag unless you ran Lentian with a -v flag for verbose. I don't know why, but I took that out in the most recent version. So now it's just a regular info tag like all the rest of them.
Yeah, probably because it's not really a problem with the itself.
Yeah. But that's the kind of thing that makes sense to me as an info tag. I mean, it isn't, and that's the other reason why not to make it a warning, because there isn't actually a problem with the package. There's nothing about the package that's going to break. It's just a cleanliness thing. One of the things I'd like to get out of the more advanced tagging system is there's a whole bunch of wish list items in Lentian that I've not written a test for, even though they're fairly easy tests, because they would annoy the hell out of a lot of people. They're aesthetics checks, basically. There's stuff like when you write your dependencies, is it always dependency space open paren close paren comma space next dependency instead of, you know, smashing all the white space together? And some people feel strongly about that kind of thing. Some people like to check that kind of thing when they're doing mentoring to teach people good coding style. Some people just really don't want to be bothered with that stuff. New classification in Lentian that's aesthetics checks. It might even be off by default, and people who want that kind of thing can turn on the whole category of aesthetics checks and include a whole bunch of stuff like that. There's one of our more famous and frequent bug reporters is particularly excited about making sure there are no trailing white space in any file, and that can sit in aesthetics at some level, and people who don't care can not care.
You can also ignore this person.
Well, yeah, I've also been successfully doing that, but...
If one binary package depends on another, and part of the files that are required, maybe man pages or init scripts, I'm dependent upon the package, is there any way Lentian can find that out, or is this
the required knowledge of this whole package? No.
So unfortunately not. That's one of the, that's exactly one of the cases where the Lintian long tag description will say, please use an override, is if the man page is in a different package that you depend on. It's also the reason why Lintian doesn't check for dangling symlinks, because we would get false positives on every single library dev package, because we don't have enough information to know that there's another package out there with that file. Yeah.
In the Debian package system, there is a column for bug reports. Can you have another column for
Google? Yes.
I think that would be a good idea. There's a link to Lintian already in the column, but there's not. It doesn't extract the information and show it to you.
Yeah, I'd like to see a column with Lintian.
I've considered it and never got around to it.
We actually do provide that information in a fashion that's even generally useful, because we generate this file for QA. Not even Lintian.log. There's even a post-processed form of that file, which we generated for some reason that I don't actually recall at the moment. I think it was for the package karma page or something along those lines. But there's a file that we generate, if I can find it, which contains only the error count in every package.
Anyway, in MOL you will also have these summaries, and the interface should be somewhat similar to a package tracking system.
Yes, it's in www.reports.qa-list.txt. So it's in lintian.debian.org/qa-list.txt, and it contains, it looks like, package name, error count, warning count. So QA could just use that and to generate that pretty easily.
I guess I thought there was more to try now.
I'm checking. I think you already provide some important information, like number W for warning and number E.
It looks like there isn't a W or an E in this particular file.
I've been working on this a little bit, but it's not really great.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Thank you.
So,
we have about 12 minutes.
Okay, good.
And I'm happy
to do some test writing stuff. Or I don't know what people are interested in, or more discussion. Or
you know, an idea of sort of how a test works? Is that the idea that you were thinking of? Or silent?
Yeah.
It's Saturday, it's been a long conference. There are cases, because of the way that Lintian archive checking works, where you're not going to be able to distinguish between a Lintian change and a package change, because they happened at the same time from Lintian's perspective. Because when I release a new version of Lintian, basically I stop the daily cron job and rerun Lintian on the whole archive. but that's a regular Lentian run, so it will pick up new packages that happen to appear since the last daily cron job. But that's not necessarily a problem. We just mark that line as, you know, two things change at the same time. We don't know which one got to.
How long does a Lentian run take?
It takes about 36 hours.
This is only in Sable i386.
Yes.
It takes, I think, a week if you run it over testing on Sable or Arch.
Profiling that at some point to figure out what takes the longest would be very interesting. You were suspecting the man page checks, which wouldn't surprise me.
I noticed an incredible increase in running time whenever those man lint stuff happened.
Yeah.
So I'd like to.
My packages that take the longest time are documentation packages for libraries.
It doesn't finish on some of the LDOS-doc or something. In my, took like more than an hour or something.
OpenOffice.org-doc-dev-doc took like 2 hours on Gluke. But that was a different problem. That's actually a bug, I think, to fix in Lentian. But the man page stuff, unfortunately, right now, in order to check the man page for man errors and other kinds of things, we actually run GROF on every man page in the package, and GROF is not the world's fastest program. Yeah.
Could peel parts be a check?
No. GROF would. Lentian is supposed to be safe, and is not actually running any codes of the package, so you can actually run it over any package. Without danger of executing random codes.
Yeah, PewParts actually runs the maintainer scripts, which is a problematic.
Okay. That should be the case. If it's not, then please fuck it up.
I was thinking about.
We run shell scripts through bash with its check option, but if that actually runs any code, that's a bug in bash.
Yeah.
Okay. But that was just because I had a bug in upstart.
Well, if object dump is buggy, we run it indeed, but still is a different issue.
Things like QParts, really ideally, what you want to do is be able to run them under QMU in their own for a VM or something along those lines. So that,
or dedicated machine.
Yeah. But, I mean, I really would like to get to the point where we can run Lentian on every incoming package in DAC and kick out packages that have the real clear, obvious errors, which means that I really care a lot about maintaining that ability to run Lentian on possibly hostile packages. Because, I mean, it's not, in theory, there shouldn't be a hostile package in the incoming queue, but, you know, it's always possible, and it's something to always be.
There are multiple tools for multiple purposes, and I don't think we should make Lentian like a master tool that's running everything else. But Lentian, you have Lentian, and besides that, PewParts, and besides that, other kinds of cross archive checks, and besides that, the dependency check analysis by QA, and etc.
So we are about 6 minutes early, but since the next talk starts exactly at 3, I'm probably voting to adjourn unless anyone else has any additional questions to let people get a chance to get upstairs. I'm planning on trying to summarize the information I gave at the beginning about sort of the general state of Lentian and the stuff that we're looking for help on. As a bit from the Lentian maintainers in the post to Denny DeVell announce, because it seemed like the original idea. So I'll try to go ahead and do that. It might take me a couple of days after I get back home. But.
Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely.
By the way, I last night here about the re-entrant.
Yes.
It looks like it's only needed if you use one of four or five functions which are undefined if you don't use that. But which are not defined in the queue file.
Oh, okay.
So it's,
and if the functions are
only in most functions.
So we should like check whether one of those four or five functions are being used, and in that case we should throw an alert and stuff like that.
Could, yeah. So that's right check to do, but it looks like
giving the information
for the PR visit microdata.
Okay.
I'd be interested to know which functions they are.
And progression until it tells us.
It might be, I'll go to check Bitlog and find out packages which produces warning about undefined functions.
Yeah, because undefined functions are generally problems anyway.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.